Over black and white clips of readers performing, a title falls into place. We Are Nevadans, Hear Us, Oates Park Art Center. On stage, a row of chairs rests alongside small tables. A white-haired woman with glasses reads off a clipboard.
Okay, imagine that you are in a Nevada coffee shop. Ever wondered what your fellow Nevadans are writing in their notebooks or on their laptops? Or just simply thinking? Well, here we go. What you are about to hear is a scripted reading of work from poems submitted to the Nevada Poetry Project, Nevadan to Nevadan, What I Need to Tell You. This project has been the focus of my work as Nevada's Poet Laureate, and I have been delighted, engaged and moved by every poem that we've received and published. These are poems from throughout the state. These words that you are about to hear are those of your fellow Nevadans, and we honor those words and those voices today. Thank you all so much for coming out. We Are Nevadans, Hear Us.
In the upper left corner, an interpreter signs as the performers speak. A smiling man with long dark hair waves to the crowd before sitting on the far end. Another guy in a bright blue shirt and red suspenders carries a script across the stage to a center table. He takes a seat beside a woman with dyed purple hair and a vibrant pink flannel. Beside her, a woman in a skirt and a sharp blazer quietly slips into the chair furthest to the left. A middle-aged man shuffles out in a button-up with a backpack slung over his shoulder. He sits beside the long-haired reader as someone in a striped polo takes a center seat. The remaining two readers meet center stage to share a quick embrace. They point to the last open table and each make their way over. The guy wears a baseball cap as he sets down a large red bag, pulling out a binder from inside. Wearing sunglasses, the woman slips off her jean jacket, sets it over the back of her chair, and takes a seat. She removes her script from her bag and then takes out a small case to set her sunglasses inside. Sliding on reading glasses in their place, the woman sets down her bag, scoots in her chair, and takes a sip from a nearby coffee mug. She opens her binder, then quickly flips it around. The person in the polo chuckles beside her, and she playfully pats their back. The readers ready their scripts as the woman with purple hair begins.
If this was November and I was Robert Frost, I would begin this letter with salutations.
To the Pinto Philly at Misfit Flats.
To the Nevada night and the Nevada day.
To the elk hunters.
The cowboy poets.
The Mirage Meadow, Vegas Valley.
A couple of hard rock miners from Winnemucca.
Old Growth, Vegas.
Angel Lake while listening to Miles Davis.
CeCe. Regarding our trip to the moon.
To all my sisters like me.
Dear child.
Dear Lake Mead.
Dear Nevadans.
Deanna.
Querida Nevada.
Adam.
Water.
Lake Tahoe.
I wonder if this is really worth the try.
Oh, I get it. It's dry. It's a desert.
My children know better.
If Red Rock could talk, they'd say,
we were once water.
Wide as rainbows,
deep as trenches.
Some native peoples doodled stories on our skin.
Some settlers engulfed them, mining our offspring for fortune.
Your view from the highlands.
Red rocks.
Dry valleys.
Perfect sunrises.
And sundowns.
Wind fights.
Sinking trees.
Communion with the sky.
Oh, and the sun. Would you just look at it?
No one watches the sky long enough.
What they don't tell you about Nevada before you come here is that there are many secrets. Some are delights discovered, others are better left buried. When I moved here, I expected to stay no more than 2 years. 20 have passed, and I remain aquí en esta tierra. once a territory of the United States, once Mexico, once fully Native American, once an ocean with sea animals that live deep, now in a state of strict boundaries, divide wondrous lakes, mountains, rivers, and people. What they do tell you about Nevada over and over again is that there's only one way to pronounce the name state. It's not true. People from all over the world live here, and they speak many languages. It's one of the most beautiful things about this place. That's why I say, like me, they probably expected to stay no more than 2 years. Many more have passed, and they remain aquí en esta tierra. What they don't tell you about Nevada, the word, is that it comes from the Spanish verb nevar, to snow. And it does. La Sierra Nevada, the snow mountain range. I like the sound of it. That's why I stayed. Living on stolen land, now divided with many secrets, with people laying claim to it, calling it home. Some pretend their ancestors sprang from Nevada soil. It's not true. Most all came from somewhere. They migrated here too, speaking many languages. Like me, they didn't plan to stay, but they did, and they have secrets. Some are delighted to discover. Others are better left buried. I am Horn Creek.
I've given birth to Las Vegas.
Had someone shown me the spring mountains at dawn, I might have loved you from the start.
All I ask is that you see me, that you allow yourself a moment of freedom, where the world opens up to your outstretched arms and the stars gather for you. I hope you take with you the knowledge of what your heart needs. And when you close your eyes, you see the creek at your toes. You see these trees rustle in the breeze.
When her grandfather said, his face picked clean of any humor, "I've already found the place for your grave if you hurt her," I simply shook his hand.
Because I believe in a father's right to warn any man about to drive his daughter across the great yawn of Nevada's belly.
As we pulled away, he said, "Do not fight over who to blame." And then he stepped into a stroke under the slender shadows of the Vegas dead of a Vegas afternoon.
He would have opened a revolver's mouth for her and blamed nothing.
How does it feel to be created by the hand of man?
Jet skis and tubes and surfboards, yachts and houseboats and water, shoes and hiking and fishing.
I'm sorry for the electricity, for the trash. I'm sorry for the gas that rests on your skin.
We take and infect and destroy and invade and disturb and control and inhabit.
What's with this town?
Growing up in Vegas, I loved pool days.
One year, I went to tennis camp.
Tired and sweaty, when we were done, we walked along the sidewalk, green grass peeking through its cracks, to the pool right across the street.
Every day, I would stand on one of the diving boards and look down. The pool seemed miles away.
The other kids yelled, "Jump!"
And every day, I would.
A connoisseur, if you will, I can inform you, Nevada has excellent water. Looking down on the curved fortitude of Hoover Dam, there was water.
Colorado, the life force of 8 states, the sole reason for the existence of Boulder City, Las Vegas, Laughlin.
The old Mormon fort, dead now, born of adobe. The stiff straw and mud didn't last, nor did the conversion of the natives of desert scrub lot, who has since been shoved to higher ground. Around the corner, vagrants put backs to faces, lean against coals that advertise payday loans. Just miles away as the helicopter flies is a construction zone. It is widely reported once the project is completed, scores of jobs will be sparked. A dead recluse from Texas has his $1 billion name on everything. An excavation would reveal a few resident bird bones,
but mostly cigarette butts of strangers that stand tall in the hard pan, like tombstones.
Methuselah knows, or ask any one of his daughters.
I swaggered my fifth generation Nevada until a friend told me.
That means you came from the takers of my homelands.
Antes incluso de que tuvieras un idioma, mi gente estaba aquí.
Before you even had a language, my people were here.
Mi gente estuvo aquí antes de que los anglosajones tuvieran agua corriente.
My people were here before the Anglos had running water.
Hablo la lengua de los ancestros colonizadores de mi padre. La lengua de mi madre fue tomada de mi abuela y mis abuelos.
I speak the language of my father's colonizing ancestors. My mother's language was taken from my grandmother's and grandfather's.
Pero estamos regresando.
But we are coming back.
Algunos anglosajones nos entienden.
Some Anglos understand us.
Algunos nos ven y se apartan de nuestro camino mientras nos reinventamos a partir de las cenizas de nuestros antepasados.
Some see us and get out of our way as we reinvent ourselves from the ashes of our ancestors. Once mammoths and saber-toothed cats roamed, a sea washed over the land, and tectonic plates rose from the underground.
Water once sprang from the center of the town.
Miners found treasure in this valley, silver, gold, and turquoise, the mother lode, and left their asses behind.
Then the railroads came, ripping through delicate crust of the Mojave. Poppies and coyotes grew freely.
Now humidity and mosquitoes swarm ponds that shouldn't exist.
But we aren't here to talk politics.
Cattle and trucks moving through spread a wildfire of bees, game species, and insects.
Smog, dust, and gluttony hang like a dirty kirk in the valley.
The mountains stand strong, feet planted for eternity.
Does snow fall on deserts?
Tread lightly.
His mother never bet money.
She gambled with his life.
She traded Lake Michigan for Lake Mead.
He used to play in the woods behind Grandma's house. In Las Vegas, he played in the desert with the rattlesnakes.
She fell for a con man. It took 5 years, but her eyes were finally opened. She found another gambler.
The boy roamed the strip, sneaked into casino pools.
She got a boat to cruise Lake Mead.
The boy had holes in his shoes, tried to find himself in the neon jungle.
Turn off the light and call upon your brightest memories.
Remember the people who held you.
Remember that you are a wonder of nature, surrounded by the butterfly, the hummingbird, the coyote, the scorpion, and a mountain within a range, within a valley that holds you in its palm, beloved.
Look at your naked mountains, beautiful and generous, as the sun gives chase to tin pots dressed in sequins to steal back the sparkle of Nevada from the crow's beak.
Fortune rides you like the bitch she is, Las Vegas.
You pirouette in a tutu of dreams.
We built fires and doctored the world with the sounds of our dancing.
Dark. Trudge back to camp. No dinner. It's long gone.
Do not tell us we are a garden who live in rich soil and receive ample sunlight.
We are weeds who push through the cracks in the concrete.
Wild weeds spring up in inhospitable ground, cracked from months of drought.
Weeds are stomped on.
Picked at.
Whispered about it.
We are not beautiful until we have grown well enough to stand on our own.
Then, and only then, will they cherish us.
But every time I meet somebody new and ask them where they're from, it's that same broken yard with the weeds and not enough water.
But we aren't here to talk politics.
I love being a tourist.
Then I remember, I moved here.
The chapel, America's favorite since 1940, became Vegas' least important the day the wee kirk of the weather wedding chapel came down.
What's with this town?
When I was a kid, I hated how everything on the strip was fake.
Everything was a knockoff.
I never understood why anyone would come for that.
I hated how my newly built schools were already breaking down. Never enough money for colored pencils.
We aren't here to talk politics.
Every year, I would be excited for school to be over.
Every summer, it would be too hot to do anything.
Sitting inside, I could still hear the cicadas buzzing.
At night, I couldn't see the stars.
Mom always came back from the casino smelling like smoke.
Scared me when the stories of people playing, losing, crying.
In the heat of the sun, I remember this town was in my mom's dreams before she came to this country.
Las Vegas is a goddess walking between two worlds like Persephone.
She's both a bachelorette party and an art museum.
Now, my dad knows every street and I feel less alone.
Maybe I don't have the stars, but I have the mountains.
I've lived in Glitter Gulch all my life.
I'm from Nevada too.
I have a wife, had a wife, for 14 years after she took residence over the Girls of Glitter Gulch strip club. I tried to catch her eye from across the street, blowing cigarette in my teeth, hoping to charm her with my silly grin, hoping she wouldn't hear the catchphrase I used to repeat to tourists every 15 minutes. Howdy, partner! We were finally married in 1994. It was a beautiful ceremony. I hardly took my eyes off my wife, dressed in her white fringe with her neon blue eyes peeking out from under her cowboy hat. Her line of bright blonde hair kicking one of her cowboy boots out into the air. We glowed at each other across the gulch, night after night for 23 years. We spoke sometimes, I think, but our voices mostly got lost in the sea of people and traffic and silence and life.
Together, we make up this land.
You, who are full of neon cowboys, hidden alleyways, and bullet-crested walls, streets forever filled with the voices of starlets and rat packs, hiding the creatures that lurk in the darkness, blowing wind through sand, bones, and sagebrush, leaving silhouettes of ghosts in the moonlight, hawks hunting, snakes sidewinding. You're as relevant to Nevada as the clouds in the sky.
When I was new to the Nevada desert, I saw little. As I've come to love my new home, I see much. Burrowing owls bobbing their heads, the sturdy charcoal ovens resisting the sun and wind, the gray and blue mountains, and my hardy neighbors driving the long, straight roads.
A familiar breeze moves against the sagebrush.
Losing count of the days since I broke containment, escaped that place. What did they call it? Area 51? I know little of this world, yet too much. My end is coming, I know, but that's probably for the best. Around me, mountains, parched land, clear skies, plants, and endless road. So dry, dry everywhere. I don't know why I write. I can only hope my final moments will help someone.
I am Tonopah, heart and soul of the past. My boundaries are rock and dirt. Some of my streets have never been paved. I'm the soul of the miners that built this state. I'm forever in the heart of the cowboys too. I am the tears that the miners cried.
Hi, big sister. It's time you know why we moved here 5 years ago.
At the park's shared picnic table, talking into the wee hours of the night, you taught me how to say Ely, with the same gentle smile and grace that friends use to instruct me in the pronunciation of Nevada?
It's Nevada, not Nevada.
Not necessarily.
You shared memories of faithful shepherd dogs who followed you from a boyhood tending sheep on vast ranches in the high desert, till your children were grown and had babies themselves. You told me how losing those good boys turned you into a cat man, your deepest regret.
But we aren't here to talk politics.
Thank you for asking me to read, for making me more of a poet in that moment than I've ever been, for welcoming me home, for being a cold drink of water and the parched wind, a shot of whiskey too.
I am the Big Smoky Valley.
One bright Sunday afternoon, we drove up the canyon and split a herd of bighorn sheep. They darted up the hill in a flash, except for one ewe who stayed close to the truck. Her gaze was fixed beyond us. We turned to see her baby on the other side. We climbed out and took pictures until the little of us said, "This is mean, we should go." We piled back into the truck bed. Daddy hit the gas and we moved up the road 100 feet or so. The baby and her mother were already up the hill and over the ridge.
I'm passing by tonight, giving you a two-fingered wave. Can you see our headlights across the Big Smoky, like slow-motion meteors heading east on the loneliest road? Hey, Spencer, first time we met was 40 years ago.
By my second visit, that concrete bathhouse had vanished, and we could steam our bodies pink, naked, and unashamed in dawn's early light. Toyabe's towering a mile above us, hiding and seeking through the wind-whipped sulfurous mist.
Another time, pickups parked by pools, RVs beached, careless bottles and cans scattered like casual obscenities. We skedaddled over Pete Summit to Potts and Monitor Valley, there neck deep in hot water, frost-biting hair, while the horses grazing close by.
One night, after fresh tracks down Kingston Canyon and drinks at the Lucky Spur, we shared your cowboy tub and a cold Coors with two bearded buckaroos and a miner from Eureka. Tell me that shit on your car ain't skis.
Remember when you hosted the whole cast of Hamlet? Reno College kids splashing and strumming guitars, all night, daybreak, puppy pile, beers for breakfast, soaking away the heartache that flesh is heir to.
Last time it was just us and you. Then dinner in Eureka, a prayer in passing for Louis' Lounge, where the fun is, a bright bar fight at the Owl Club. We dodged that one, and down the street, drinking at Jackson House, decided to go to Double. Siante.
I wonder if Paiute and Shoshone called you way back then. Not Spencer, that's for sure. Were you always a fool? Or just a trickling spirit of silence, stillness, and distance? Looking southward, the earth curves, bare like our breasts, and honest.
7 months after leaving our life, I watched my lover ascend a canyon of fiery aspens. Hovering above us is a wispy cloud that offers respite from the central Nevada sun that stains my skin pink. He carries his weight like water, with the same sureness that you had when you look through me and say, "I'd never leave."
You don't know.
This Pacacta state is full of us.
Mashuga for coming here.
And here we are.
Beyond the
dentists,
doctors,
lawyers,
professors.
The boy who rolled their eyes. Of course he's Jewish.
There's that baker in Austin.
That Babylon weaver.
Harlan Byner.
Dayton poet.
Eureka swordsmith.
Fernley grocery clerk.
Gardnerville silk trader.
Hawthorne social worker.
Indian Hills salesman.
Jackpot dealer.
Kingston buyer.
Block builder.
Mesquite ceramicist.
Mogul.
Nixon innkeeper.
Lord North Las Vegas astronomer.
Oahu DJ.
Corrupt proprietor.
Ruth.
Hello.
Dealer.
Searchlight mucker.
Silver Peak Millet.
John Fire Desert.
Virginia City Prop Man.
Washoe Valley Farrier.
Zephyr Cove Sailor.
Mule Mason Bear Mule Zenon.
And that's all you need to know.
You will find me curled up on your floorboard in your shirt, my heart's unquiet hideout.
Hola, tia. ¿Qué onda? I'm fine. It's really the sky that scares me. I'm used to being in danger, dark, disturbed, and with my fists balled up. I can enjoy the quiet night sky while painting the crooked plum tree out back. If I'm looking for trouble and excitement, I travel to the casinos or dance clubs. Friends are in abundance here. We have a grocery store. I'm not saying there aren't vatos looking for trouble, but...
On the way out, I noticed a young couple eating French fries, ketchup sauce made into a heart around the plate.
She writes a poem that ends, "Thanks, Dad. Thanks for letting me be who I am."
Love is a wrong way sign, weathered by the dry wind.
I fear it is all you will remember. The way it entered the room, the softness with which it broke the frost, how it laid against my bed frame on those cold winter evenings. And oldest friends became buoys against the tide in a land that had not received a drop of rain in 64 days.
Grateful for any rain shower, wake up with the hard drum of rooftop raindrops.
Strange how I am no longer underwater, yet still find myself propelling up for air.
If you cut apart my spine like a tree, could you count the rings and point out the exact orbit where I became finite?
Yes. The air knows the land by face, not by name. And I am not sure, if given a knife, how I would carve the lines.
You've been running through my head again, like a coyote with its loose skin hanging off its body, panting through a labyrinth. You could be a cousin of Florida with your tourist traps and Elvis impersonators, your disappointed ghosts and shattered motels.
Those curves on the hot street, the strip of shape below the shoulder, the glitter against pale, walking past me, showing me a new memory of my youth. Now a faint glimmer for an old man, jaundiced by experience, jealous of opportunity, still with the power to see pleasure ready to bloom.
You aren't far enough, and you'll find her. She's the memory of something worthy of the name Palace. But now, the desert has taken her.
I walk the silver terrace and think about her fondly, and I'll still smell the earth her foundation will fertilize, and think about how beautiful, how frightening she was.
We both found something in Nevada, almost 130 years apart. You passing through, a kid afoot with a wagon train, and me, an adult, driving a worn-out car.
I'm from Nevada, too.
I've lived here my whole life.
Believe me, I really do hear you. I know how incredibly frustrated you must be. They don't even pronounce your name right. Only loving you for being a swing state.
But we're not here to talk about politics.
I get that you aren't just hookers and roulette, more than freaked burners and flower-fine alkaline dust. That you never were just quick divorces and quicker weddings. Of course, I've heard that nasty gossip about you being a wasteland, a dumping ground for glowing debris from someone else's old reactor.
In the morning, the sounds of the coffee pot brewing wake me. You call from the kitchen, ask if I want a cup. You know me so well. I think about when I first got off that plane, a transplant starting a new life in the desert, and that sunrise over the mountains. I hope you slept well.
I never get to sleep.
How much of us is left in the air when we've gone, in the soil?
Everyone I meet here says people can't move far enough north these days.
The fires will drive everyone upward before long.
I find it hard not to choke on all the grief sometimes, and the dust we kick up riding ramshackle motorbikes among the sagebrush.
Petroglyphs. The handprints and zigzag figures worked into the crumbling sandstone crags out by the hot springs.
Do you remember?
We weren't supposed to be there, and that's how it was the day I lost you. You should have been elsewhere.
I imagine the tree they planted for you in the park down the street from our high school must be getting quite tall, Len.
Over the horizon, smoke rolls high and black.
Lay a coin on the rail and hurry.
Stand in awe and grin. Hug the ground with bare feet as the earth trembles.
Find the coin smashed flat and thin.
Shovelfuls of me lining the highway. Jagged dreams and piles like rocks and my guts like leaves litter the landscape.
They call it a wasteland, a place to be avoided, a place you overlook. They discount the place's worth and make its name a verb.
Show me new places in the city.
I on Sea Mountain, above town, two boys sit, their heads over sagebrush, out of breath, looking down. Hearts free and hands filled with warm sand, the boys look across the valley floor, track the iron line leading into town. A covey of quail clucks somewhere in the sage, a magpie scolds a meadowlark singing, the smell of sagebrush, sharp in the warmth of the sun. Under the expanse of the old B&T shed roof, a hammer pounds, a bell rings, and the whoosh and chug of steam cylinders tattle on number 26, prowling the roundhouse yard below in the town. Impatient to get on with it, the boys run down the hill to play out their summer dream.
We met on the uneven cedar-brown worn wood slabs banked in front of Mark Twain Saloon like a threshing floor, buttressed against the silver dollar and a bucket of blood. Climb the hill above St. Mary's of the Mountains, catch some rays straining from under the cold, wintry sun. How would I make any difference in this time, in this western place with its wild nomenclature wrapped around every mine, stool, bar, and bell? How was I going to get from there to here?
Remember, my friend, how we danced?
Oh, how we danced.
Time was I'd want to take you home, make you mine. Ride you as you race the wind. Now, I'd just like to be you for a moment as you skim the desert floor, to be that free.
Complaint to March 2023, from Reno Sparks, Nevada.
On a scale of 1 to 50 degrees, my ability to speak without grit, frozen the sage leaves in Lemon Valley, is in the single digits.
This must be the only state where everyone knows the state fossil is the ichthyosaur, a small fondness to hold on to. But sometimes I lift an icky beer in his honor on the shores of Pyramid Lake, where some say he swam.
One summer, I felt a rustling and looked up to my rearview mirror to see most of the heat-unhinged pages of poetry books windblown from my back windows. The wind swept most of them into a doorway of an old office building where a boy each night liked to lean on his one thin line of methamphetamine. He blamed the birthmark he picked at the door's glass reflection before he noticed all the poems like leaves across the threshold. He sat behind an old sand ashtray, lighting one burnt end with another, as the Geiger counter of river crickets rose behind him. Reading each poem, he folded his favorite into his boot before walking back to last century's squat divorce cottages, knowing mother will have begun her shift at the gold and silver, knowing nothing would change.
When Virginia Street was the main street, no one had dreamed of putting in a freeway yet.
I used to think Hot August Nights was all about the classic cars. I didn't care about the cruising around Grandpa's 1940 Merce. What I really cared about was getting to hang out with my grandparents for a whole week.
We built a cardboard rocket ship, painted SS Powerpuff on its side, and tucked your bear dog beside us in his special sidecar. Your Golden Valley trailer park looked like a clay miniature in a diorama as we rose over the high desert. Through cotton ball clouds and dark Canadian geese, before we pierced the exosphere like your grandma's quilting needle.
Downtown Reno at night, see the lights. See the arc screaming in the blinding neon lights. The biggest little city in the world.
When we were hip to hip on the top of that hill, and the valley was cradled in our hands with Reno splayed out under our eyes like an autopsy, do you remember me pointing out 4th Street? The artery of lights flowing neatly from the hospital I was born in, down past the motel where my grandparents honeymooned till it dwindled into the Sierras.
Today it was 104 degrees in Reno. Felt like 110 if you worked near the pavement on Prater like I do. Everyone's been waiting on the coast to bring in the gusts, the rain, the clouds, anything. But it keeps just getting caught in the mountains that neither of us are coming around anytime soon.
Power lines framed the neighborhood trailhead, dissecting clear blue skies in the summer and balancing thin shells of snow in the winter.
At night, you were the place where things came together.
Cigarettes to lighters.
Lips to lips.
Childhood to adolescence.
Do you ever get tired of being used like that? Night after night?
I know I did.
In the morning, dog walkers would huff at the flattened Trojan boxes and shattered Corona bottles. And at the start of Sunday afternoon hikes, their teenage kids would pretend not to notice.
One cloudy winter afternoon, walking the family dog, I got lost in the desert beyond your cracked doorway of disheveled gravel and dark teenage memories.
The first rule of the lost, climb the highest hill.
Hike straight vertical until the dog and I were both panting and found at the top, a weathered picnic table. I entered the mist, sat down, felt unfindable. You gave me that. I've never found that table since. How much of what I know about myself is real?
Can you see Slide, Mount Rose, Peavine?
Gray silhouettes by 3 o'clock.
Am I on the trail?
It's almost tradition for me now, every Friday at noon to drive there, a fistful of ones in my hand, ready for another paper-thin slice of pizza.
Already, I am waiting for autumn and its small glimpses of resurrection. At Idlewild, the leaves will change color like scales. Did I tell you about my sister who came before? She spends only 3 days on Earth. It was October, the year of the dragon, and my parents called the priests to perform the last rites. I don't believe in purgatory, but it sounds preferable to heaven. Imagine! Sitting on a cloud for the rest of eternity, sounding a trumpet you never learned to play. When our fathers talk about heaven, they say they'll reap the rewards for their suffering, the women they put up with, the work they endured. The more they look up, they forget to look down. When our mothers talk about heaven, they describe a spring day. At 7, I imagine the rolling hills and Mama Mary welcoming us with open arms, like a scene from The Sound of Music. Now,
I wonder if our parents' heaven would be my hell, the stagnant, perpetual grace of it all. What if heaven is not a fixed destination, but a pendulum between one season and the next? See the leaves waiting to fall so they can shroud the ground? In Reno, days swing between the heat of summer and a glimpse of winter. Let heaven be a mile marker rather than a finish line. Let heaven be a chrysalis rather than a butterfly. Let resurrection happen like the fall.
A Bodog read, thought resurrection might look like an autumn in Reno. Recently, I've noticed the sparrows roost in the lilac branches until I reach and unhook the column feeder to fill it. And yesterday, the clouds waited to shake out their sheets of rain until after I was under porch eaves with the dry, chipped nest of last year's doves. Last week, I watched Ada, pilgrim of dirt, dig for insects near Hunter Creek. Beetles are her favorite, but she settles for worms. Ada believes people in top hats and berets bring blue bushes and red ladders to polish the stars. Every night, I ask, and she nods without looking up.
Reno, I walk my life with you the way October spins out these days. We are both slow, but the year and I aren't dying yet.
I walk the river near sunset with its delectable green and shadow. Couples walking terriers, a kid carrying books without a backpack.
The Trekkie was growing shopping carts in one, a box and canvas bag. Tarp covered a bright blue with no person rooted to it.
Under the Keystone Bridge, a boy stood in river shallows, shouting to the other side, God, take me. If you are God, take me. You fucker.
My friend Andrew would stop, would say, hey man, God is a fucker sometimes, but you can't talk with him from here. Dry off.
I was not Andrew tonight.
Like the others, I passed by, but when I got to my car, I pulled out two paper bags of tomatoes meant for my neighbor. I carried them back, put one on top of the stony bank under the bridge, the other on top of the blue tarp.
I'm going to live here one day. Just 14, but I knew what I wanted. They call it the old Southwest.
A cat follows me, dodging behind bushes as I turn around. Just like that fall so many years ago, trees are green, gold, and orange, and in the air wood smoke and fleeting aroma of stubborn apples not willing to let go and give in to winter. Not yet.
When we were at UNR together, didn't the world seem like a worked over place that contained little gristlings of shine and spark everywhere? I hesitate to say that we found so many of them at the bottom of bottles and in the backs of bars. But when you're young, you're young. Satellite, Silver Peak, Blue Moon Shooters, Shenanigans, now, all our old haunts sound like a missyllabled haiku to me, or an overwrought tone poem. We were brothers back then. I was an asshole some of the time, well, a lot of the time. I'm sorry I introduced you to shoplifting. I've been wrestling with philosophy again. Did we know what we wanted back then? It doesn't matter, I don't think. I hope your dog is barking fervently and ignorantly right now, howling at every possible possibility. Give her a pat for me.
Shannon was late for our coffee date. A coyote got hold of a small dog, was dragging it across Highway 50 when she had to slam on her brakes. Shannon pulled over, fought off the predator with a stick, and searched the area for tags before taking the dog to the vet.
Thought of her college cat, Zeppelin. Together they loaded into the pickup, drove to the hill behind the desert cemetery. where a big white Y for Yarrington was painted on the rocks facing the valley. Shannon's dad dug a hole, maybe 3 feet deep, wrapped Zeppelin in a white towel.
Still breathing, he laid Zeppelin into the dirt, shot him with a pistol, shoveled dirt atop his body before his blood had time to color the cloth.
Shannon understands sometimes grief is easier than hunger.
She says, I know this sounds big. Pauses. Remembers, I'm from Nevada too.
Forget Halloween. We celebrate our state here.
It's a little weird, but we do get the day off. It's weird.
I write a poem about the wild horse, this enduring, wind-drinking runner of desert and plain.
All the stories I know about horse are secondhand, told to me by buffalo, an oiler with long hair who met him deep in the belly of an open pit 55 miles out Jungle Road at the Hard Rock Highcroft Mine.
They worked deep through in the boneyard at the edge of the flat rock, chest to chest with the mill rats and powder crew working a Super 7 shift, scratching the surface of the earth to birth the fluorescence of load ore through a leach field, looking for a speck of gold.
He was pre-med before he was a PM tech in gray striped diggers and steel-toed boots and spent a half-life ascending concentric circles, anticipating a carefully timed blast.
He preferred to sleep on the Bluebird bus, covered in bug dust, dreaming about the end of a long change when he and Buffalo could run in the high desert plains through the red blush of the sunrise, over the peak of Blue Mountain, and exchange their paychecks at the Double S for an open tab and a game of pool.
After 30 years of mining, his body has long scars like rips in the earth from bad accidents and beautiful women who loved him but could not outlive him.
To remember them, he built a keystone pyramid in the kitchen of his single wide, stacked tin cans on top of each other, and put his heart in the middle.
Running down the glass like vinyl siding on a tract house in the desert, the car rolls smoothly over Interstate 80. Lovelock, Winnemucca, Battle Mountain, Basin, and Range. I'm riding through it, and it's riding through me. The scars are open, the range is free.
Hold my leather cowboy hat, used to cover the hole in my work shirt, not quite tucked into my Wrangler jeans. Soon I will walk inside, screen door slamming, watch the secret light of the bright moon, allow the nighttime stars to beam and dance, that simple pleasure that big towns never enjoy. 5 generations meet up tomorrow. Kids will ride bikes. Dogs will run beside us. Oats Park in sight.
A pack of Winston's falls, covered now in the first snow. Wind chimes from an A-frame. Frank is shoveling his wok. Every July, he slow cooks ribs for the 4th. The whiff hangs round till fall.
Coughing doesn't help. It just wakes up the dog. Outside, the smoke swirls through the pine trees and paints them with ash.
I gathered the ash and dead lake sand into a mason jar.
By the time I finally stumbled into town, there were lichen-covered gravestones to the code and Civil War horses to contend with. There were scrappy grouse who deftly avoided dancing hooves in the city square, and I swear, tried to warn me of the storm to come.
Just a suitcase and a husband. You return the favor. Storm clouds, bolts of lightning, flash floods, that desert drought, dangerous high-speed winds, quiet moments on the peak.
We drove over the Sierra Nevada range from the deep end of border-crossing fantasies. A woman offers a solution and a key. A man turns the ignition. This will take us far. That's how it went down. Goodbye is a tide that does not recede. It washes us inland.
You're consigned to this cold highway, which you keep driving, still fiddling with the dial, still hoping that some faint signal will somehow, clear and true, come through.
Driving on the 95 northbound, turning the bend, the rearview mirror filled with the brown of the mountains, sandwiched between the blue of the sky and the blue of the lake in front of me.
Rolling waves of scorched sands. America, is that how you see me? When time comes for winter, cars from California will slide off the roads because they didn't get snow tires this year, because they didn't believe in my winters. My children know better.
Driving home.
Across the gray yawn of Nevada's belly.
The sky diamond dusted if you turn the headlights off.
Blast your music and drive fast. The officers won't bother you on the vast stretches of nothing. Tell you from me though, they hide in plain sight at the edge of little ghost towns on the only main road. Your biggest threat there is a speeding ticket.
And maybe getting haunted.
I'm writing to tell you about the graveyard of cars and that I owe you $5. I saw a living human this time.
I have enough real ghosts to dance with in this desert of old wounds.
Ghost feet pad at night, use sage-rest rooms to sweep away footprints of their progeny.
Disappointed ghosts.
Root cellar ghosts.
Silhouettes of ghosts in the moonlight.
Turning, spinning, dancing over the landscape like some ghostly spirit.
Born in the Pacific, where atmosphere starts to spin counterclockwise, sucking up water as it goes, up and over, dropping moisture as it climbs, piling snow to form natural reservoirs, heading for the arid sands of Nevada.
I am yet just a river.
Keep me safe.
Keep me.
A river running year round.
Maybe they saw the gold they were seeking in the Green River bottoms and decided this was home.
Went to the poetry gathering in Elko, Nevada, trying to keep an open mind about rhymes, blankets of stars, cowboy bars, the sing-song sameness of how they toil aimless for no monetary gain, though backs ache and muscles pain, because they wouldn't try to trade the fates with the likes of Bill Gates. For there's nothing like the wide open spaces they collectively embrace. Yet, partner, I walked amongst them in my thrift store cowboy boots and plaid cowboy shirt with plural buttons, filling my eyeballs full of literary cowboys and book riding ranchers. Not that I was scoping them out with anything less than honorable intentions, not like I was looking for a buckaroo to buck me, but just to see grown men all decked out in their Wild West best. They could have put peacocks to shame. They came in all sizes, long and thin, short and thick.
Now, when I flip up my collar to keep out the cold, I still hear the faint signal of your reply. The way that wind is silent until it has a tree to breathe through, or a door to slam, or a sail to catch.
I know all too intimately the composition of barren landscapes, but somehow the remembered scent of a full flowering, the allure of all that smooth bare bark, shockingly adorned, the elegant, eloquent silence of such blatant loveliness has drowned out the howling gusts of wind.
You are Angel Lake. You sit high in the East Humboldt Range, where time is your glacier.
Spring can't come soon enough.
Why did I ever believe, dry as I am, that I would end as anything other than smoke?
I am a prodigal daughter of the Golden West.
Home can mean anywhere, as long as there's smoke and a couple of people willing to help you hide from it.
Ask any one of the daughters.
We all know who's right.
According to my driver's license, the stickers on my car.
Home means
the place that I am proud to admit is my home.
Pronounce it how you like.
We all know who's right.
Do not forget.
Home means
the comfort of the hills.
And cowboys and deserts and wild horses and sagebrush.
The high desert has turned green.
Remember, I'm from Nevada.
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 And I'm from Nevada too.
The readers each set down their scripts and smile out at the crowd. The white-haired woman steps back out on stage, applauding and grinning at the audience as she does. She turns to the crowd.
Thank you, Nevada, for giving us your language, your voice, your hearts. We appreciate it. I'm getting emotional. And now I want to thank my readers, Joanne Millard, Nyla Norsa, Frank F. Mullet, Andrea Martinez, Everett Ray Dorf, Daniel Alicia Cry, Steve Silverson, and Jean Marie Simpson.
The view of the performers fades into a sprawling view of a mountain range. We are Nevadans. Hear us. Credits: Andrea Martinez, Joanne Malari, Everett Ray George, Gail Marie Pommeyer, Jean Marie Simpson, Nyla Northsun, Daniel Enrique Perez, B. Fulkerson, and Frank X. Mullen. Logos appear over black: Nevada Arts Council, Academy of American Poets, and Mellon Foundation. Music by Willie Vlaughton. American Sign Language interpreter Leprintess Bradley. Audio describer Sam Jankowski.